Good morning and welcome to the seventh meeting of the Culture, Tourism, Europe and External Relations Committee in session five. I'd like to remind members and the public to turn off mobile devices, and any members using electronic devices to access committee papers, can you please ensure they're turned to silent? No apologies have been received. Our first item of business today is a decision to take agenda item three, consideration of evidence heard in private. Are members agreed? Our second item of business today is an evidence session on the BBC Charter and Service Agreement with the BBC and Ofcom. Before we proceed, I'd like to draw attention to my register of members' interests as a weekly columnist with the Daily Record newspaper. I'd like to welcome the witnesses to the meeting, Lord Hall of Birkenhead, Director General of the BBC, Donalda MacKinnon, Director of BBC Scotland, and Ken MacQuarrie, Director of Nations and Regions at the BBC. And I'd like to invite Lord Hall to make an opening statement.
Thank you very much indeed, Convene, and thank you for the invitation to come here today, but also the way that you have been content to move the date. I think, as you can see from yesterday's announcement, I really did want to come when we had some very concrete things to say, but thank you for your patience on that. When I came last time to your predecessor committee, I stressed things we were looking at from the BBC, which were around rebalancing provision of news, improving a portrayal, growing the spend in Scotland for the nation overall, but also for Scotland, the importance of partnerships, and also devolving more decision-making to Scotland. And I think yesterday, when we were able to announce the results of our thinking, we all felt this was a very big day for the BBC in Scotland. And let me just remind you of the context. You'll know it, but I'll remind you that the BBC is having to make considerable savings, £800 million over the first 5 years of the new charter, a licence fee which is flat in real times, in terms. Nonetheless, we were able to make the largest investment some decades in BBC Scotland, £40 million, which I think will transform our offer from BBC Scotland. And at the heart of our thinking was our audiences and giving our audiences choice and ensuring that they can have quality. Two big things, a channel for Scotland, £19 million of new money, £30 million in total, which is comparable, like for like, content spend, not overall cost, but content spend with BBC Four. The details are to be worked out by Donalda and her team here. I think it's a really exciting, creative proposition with a 9 o'clock news at the core, and I believe giving viewers in Scotland a real choice, as indeed they have choice in radio. spending on news within that will increase to over £7 million a year, and that's going to benefit not just the new 9 o'clock news, but also Reporting Scotland, ALBA and Radio Nangale. And because of this, we are also increasing our investment in ALBA, both with weekend news, which when I went to Stornoway a few months ago was clearly something that was needed. Also giving ALBA and BBC Scotland, the new channel, a chance to co-commission. But we're also confirming an extra £1.2 million of costs that we're taking on, which should free up money for ALBA overall. In all, this is 18 new jobs. And if you add the 20 we're also committing to with our local democracy proposals, 100 jobs in total. That's the biggest investment, I think, in the, and if I can call it news and industry, for a considerable amount of time when others are cutting back, we're investing as we should be. The second thing is we are sustaining an extra £20 million a year investment in network production here. If we compare the base figure of 15-16, when I think you took evidence before from Anne Bulford and others about this, we spent £65 million in the year. We are now committing to an extra £20 million, which should take us this year to over £90 million in Scotland for the network, and in 1920, that year, just under £90 million. It'll go up and down a little bit according to commissions, but that commitment is there. And this is the result of changes we've made, we've said we would make, and we are making. Commissioners now in Scotland for comedy, for science, for children's. We'll be shortly announcing the drama commissioner too. We've created a drama development fund. A few weeks ago, we launched a writer's room for Scotland. That's all what's helping to really kind of lift the creativity of BBC Scotland and Scotland broadly on the networks. I think it's a great vote of confidence in the creativity of Scotland. We also believe this is going some way towards increasing the amount of licence fees spent in Scotland versus what is actually raised here. And again, I know that's something the committee takes a great deal of interest in. So in conclusion, yesterday was not about saying we've reached some sort of destination, but I think we have laid, I hope we have laid the foundations for an ambitious future. Yesterday was a declaration of intent to significantly increase our support for the Scottish creative economy, to widen opportunities for production in-house, but also with indies as well. But most important of all, to serve audiences by providing them with more programmes of quality from Scotland, about Scotland and to the network, and also giving them greater choice. Thank you very much for allowing me to make those few words, Convener.
Thank you very much, Lord Hall. And I think you'll have seen from the response to the announcement this week that there's a lot of positivity in response and in this Parliament, particularly because there was cross-party support for the proposal almost 10 years ago now of a Scottish digital network, and obviously the new jobs will be very welcome as well. You'll be aware that one of the criticisms that has been made, or perhaps not criticisms but queries, is that the Scottish Digital Channel proposed 10 years ago was costed at £75 million, and this new channel will have £30 million of money, which isn't all new. And I wondered whether you could tell us, is that a starting point? Do you expect that to increase? And do you think you'll be able to deliver the services for that amount of money?
Yeah, and maybe I can draw in Donalda too. I can't compare with the proposal that was put forward a decade ago, because I don't quite know how that was, the numbers were put together. But what I can confirm is there are no hidden overheads in this. The 30 million we're talking about is, in crew terms, cash to spend on the channel. If you look at a BBC 4 comparison, then there are other things we lay into it, which are not the cash you can spend on content. This is absolutely cash we can spend on content. We've looked at an outline. I mean, Donald has done an outline for what the channel will look like, and 60% of the output will be new commissions, which I think is a really very, very good start. But as you're sort of saying, I want now for Donald and the team to take this exciting moment when to create a new channel, and let's see how it goes in its first year. Let's see how it goes in the second year. You know, what happens thereafter? Let's see if we can at some point win more monies for the BBC by proving that we're giving good services, then I would love to see more money going into that channel. But, you know, the aim now is to launch it. I don't know whether Convener Donalda might want to say a few things about the channel.
Yes.
And perhaps, Donalda, in your comments, you could perhaps tell us if there's going to be a head of channel, a director of the channel.
So, to answer that question first, yes, there will be leadership around this new service, but it will form part of a wider plan that I have, which I haven't announced yet, so I probably wouldn't be prepared to announce it here today. But rest assured, yes, of course, there will be appropriate leadership around this channel. But just to echo what Tony said, this is not a like-for-like comparison with what the Broadcasting Commission set out to achieve with their digital network. As Tony said, we are starting with a cash content spend, hypothecated £30 million. No overhead in that. Also, what we would hope to do is to leverage our economies of scale across the BBC. We want to co-commission. We also want to take advantage where we can of potentially simulcasting, also working with our network colleagues and indeed others across nations and regions, but also with other broadcasters, hopefully across Europe and why not the world.
Right, okay. That's all very interesting. And do you expect to sell original programming around the world?
I'm really ambitious for that, Convener. I do think that what we have here in Scotland is quite unique, not just in terms of what we can produce from here. Our unique selling point is our Scottishness, I've always said that. But we also, I believe, have one of the best creative communities in the world. I think we have the capacity and the capability to produce fantastic content that should and can very easily sell. Mm-hmm. I've already been in conversation with Tim Davey, the director of BBC Worldwide. We're working on some plans together. I would hope to see that these come to fruition over the next few years.
Okay. To go back to the funding, 30 million. You spend 60 million, for example, commissioning Match of the Day rights. So 30 million, it doesn't go that far. In terms of, you quite rightly referred to the committee's interest in the proportion of the licence fee that's spent in Scotland. Now, in your good year, it's currently not a great year at 55%, but in your good year, I think it was 2014, you were spending about 63%. Understand that with this new money, you're up to 67%. Well, that's still a long way behind both Northern Ireland at 75% and Wales at 95%. Are we going to get to a position where Scotland is at parity with those other nations in the UK?
So, I mean, I think you're right to say we've taken a not a good year, 15-16. If you take it the previous year, of course, that was boosted by money we put in for the both for the Games and also for the referendum. So, again, it's an artificial year. And what I want to do is to take a base where we can absolutely determine the 20 million, and you can see that, and we're kind of, holding ourselves to account for that, which gets us to 68% from a figure of 55%, which I know you dwelt on a lot when Anne Bulford was here before. We started. If you add to the 68% another sum, which is for distribution, in other words, I think we should be including in these figures the amount we pay over 30 million to distribute our programmes around Scotland. You get to another 11% on that, which gets you to a figure of about 79%. But nonetheless, you're right. I mean, compare the 68% on content versus Northern Ireland, which is about 74%, I think. We're moving and we're shifting, and I think the challenge now to BBC Scotland, to BBC ourselves, is to see whether, in terms of the network spending, we can do more than we're currently committing to do. And that depends on good ideas, that depends on winning commissions. We're open for making sure, that's why we've got the commission is based here, to make sure we can get as good stuff on the network as we can. So, this is not a fix. This is, as I said at the beginning, this is very much a starting point.
And there might also be an opportunity to extend the amount that we spend on network radio, for example, from Scotland, and indeed some of our digital services.
Okay. I know that a lot of members want to come in specifically on the new channel, but this is a wider evidence session about the charter renewal. So what we're going to do is take questions on the new channel for part of our evidence session, and then move on to other topics. So I'll bring in Lewis MacDonald first.
Thank you very much. And clearly, as the convener has said, new jobs, 80 new jobs for journalists and substantial new investment is clearly very welcome. What I'd like to understand is how that's going to operate in relation to Scotland as a whole, because clearly it's very, there's always a risk with the creation of any new investment that it becomes a centralised, concentrated in a single centre. Of course, there has to be a centre, but I wonder if I can ask you about the regional character of the new channel and how far it will draw from the other production centres in Scotland besides Glasgow in order to ensure that it reflects the country as a whole.
I think your point is well made in terms of a remit to cover the whole of Scotland. We're absolutely conscious of that, and that this investment will be spread across the whole of Scotland. We're very proud of the skills that our factual team have in Aberdeen, for example. They're producing outstanding work. It's work that we really appreciate. And that remit to cover the whole of the nation and all the regions of the nations, and to ensure that every part of the country benefits from that investment, is front and foremost in our minds.
And I think we have a real opportunity to do that, and in fact to strengthen some of our other bases beyond Glasgow, and we most certainly will do that. I mean, I think the opportunity in terms of the investment in the journalists alone offers us that, but also our local democracy, the other 20 journalists we would absolutely envisage that they will be spread across the country. That's the essence of that proposal. But as Kenny said, it is massively important to us to reflect this whole nation, if we make arguments about out-of-London production, then we have to consider what we're doing in Scotland likewise.
That's reassuring. And Ken MacQuarrie mentioned factual content from Aberdeen. Clearly also there's radio, there's news production, there's online content.
Yeah.
Presumably the intention with the new channel is to reinforce those outputs in places like Aberdeen and other centres.
I think there are enormous opportunities here across all our platforms. I said that yesterday, and I think we will definitely see that happening over the next months and years.
And can I ask about the relationship, the Director General, you mentioned in your introduction, the way in which the new channel would allow work with Reporting Scotland, with ALAPA and with Raja Nangail, and support and reinforce the work that's done there. Can you perhaps tell us a bit about how that will work? What is the collaboration going to be on, particularly, I guess, on news and current affairs, but across the board between the new channel and BBC One Scotland and ALAPA and Raja Nangail?
Well, I mean, I think, as Donalda has been saying, I think the possibility here now to collaborate, you know, in a very direct way. So, you know, ALBA will get weekend news consistently for the first time, I think, is really important. I think for Donalda to come together with the ALBA team and say, now, how can we co-commission between BBC Scotland and BBC ALBA? I think that's really important. But I just want to underline and underscore something that Donalda said, which is, I think, you know, the BBC is a team, and I very much want Donalda to draw on the resources of the whole BBC behind BBC Scotland, the channel, and all the things that we do. And one of the things which I think is good around this issue of the news and the 9 o'clock news versus Scottish Six and all of that sort of stuff is, I know that we can put the entire resources, journalistic, editorial resources, global as well as UK, behind a news at 9 o'clock for an hour, which I think, talking to the teams yesterday, I think they can do something which is really, really new and fresh, using all the resources of the BBC, which I think could, I hope, teaches a few lessons to news broadcasters around the world. I'm really excited by that proposition.
And if I understand that correctly, you're talking about access to international correspondence.
Absolutely.
In a way that it will be more straightforward when
news
is the one BBC offering at the time.
Completely, Mr. McDonald. I mean, I've edited the 6 o'clock news far, far, far too long ago. I know how at that time of night the demands are huge on one network, never mind another one or three or more. Actually, at 9 o'clock, the entirety of the resources, international and national, are going to be behind the 9 o'clock news on BBC Scotland. And I also, we were talking about this last night after it, we were also saying, what I think success would also be is that the news teams in PQ also saying, we're going to commission something which is entirely off everybody else's agenda, but it's for us, and use the correspondents around the world or whatever to do that. And I think that's a really exciting prospect.
Excellent. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Yeah, Richard.
Thank you very much for giving evidence today, and I too warmly welcome the announcement. Some of us on this committee have been in Parliament since 1999, and finally in 2017 we've got some progress. So it's taken some time to get here, and hopefully we won't have to wait another 18 years for the next big step forward in terms of BBC Investment Scotland. But it's a warmly welcomed announcement. Can you tell me how you'll be defining success of the new channel? Because quite clearly people still have the opportunity of watching BBC One Scotland, but now the new channel a couple of years onwards.
I mean, I think we need to work out our detailed metrics and be clear to the public about those nearer the time, for reasons I'll explain in a moment. I mean, my aim is to ensure that viewership for BBC Scotland, BBC One Scotland, grows. That's what we want to do, and our satisfaction indices begin to change. It's really hard at the moment to set detailed metrics, but we will, for BBC Scotland, because Donalda has the enviable job now of saying, OK, so what do I want to place? Do I want to do this? Do I want to do that? Do I want to use sport here, news here, whatever? And so much is going to depend on that construction, which creatively has got to be led here in Glasgow, here in Scotland, by Donalda. So that's one thing. The second thing, in the spirit of honesty, we need to also make sure this has a good EPG position. So it's as high up as we can make it in the EPG. That means a number of discussions. Now we've announced this, with partners, you know, with Freeview, with Sky, etc., to try to raise that EPG position.
You may want to explain that for people listening.
I'm so sorry. The electronic programme guide, the number you are when you turn to the Freeview or you turn to Sky, that kind of also matters. And what we want to do is to get this as high up as we can. It may interest the committee, I don't know, but this is something which, as the Digital Economy Bill goes through the Lords at the moment, prominence, I think, is a really important issue for public service channels. There are amendments going down in the Lords. Whatever backing you can give to the notion that PSBs, public service broadcasters, should get real prominence in this new world that we are entering in, that would be most welcome. I think it's a really important issue because we can do great content, we can do great children's services, but you also want to make sure our viewers can get to them easily, and that's not always the case.
In terms of the debate over the Scottish Six, which is one of the issues that's been bubbling away since 1999, just about, people will still have the opportunity of watching BBC One Scotland, as well as the new channel, as I said before. Are you saying that a Scottish Six is mutually exclusive in terms of the new channel?
Yes, because I think we've got, and we've been going through these, the thinking about this thoroughly over the last few months. You see, what we've got at 6 o'clock is a 6 o'clock news from London, where the audience is growing. A Reporting Scotland, which is the most watched news programme in Scotland, and what we want to offer is choice. You can watch it as it is at the moment on BBC One Scotland, or you can go and see something which is wholly Scottish, with a Scottish perspective, at 9 o'clock. Also, I don't want to let off the journalism from London from their duty to make sure that they are reporting significant stories properly and carefully. And this is a fourth bridge repainting issue. We've just got to keep at that to make sure that reporting what's going on in Scotland properly, and when big issues affect the whole of the UK, those again bring a Scottish perspective. And I think that's an area we just have to keep pressure. Ken, I know, believes in this very strongly. We've just got to keep that pressure up.
Okay. Well, I think the next round of question will be in commissioning of programmes, but I think that if you want to attract viewers to the new channel, it'll have to be other top quality output alongside 9 o'clock news.
Yeah.
So
okay, and if I can say to members, if we're going to get to the next round of questioning, we'll need to make it with questions and answers as brief as possible on the new channel. Jackson Carlow.
Thank you. Morning. Can I first of all say that in an era where every cliffhanger in River City and EastEnders is trailed in the press for about 6 months in advance, you did a remarkable job keeping this completely secret until yesterday. I'm pleased to hear what you say about new leadership. I can see it's all the potential candidates ranged behind you there. Can I start off following on the Scottish Six? I welcome what you've said about that. I had no objection in principle. But burned in my memory is the 60 Minutes experience of a format that did huge reputational damage to BBC journalism a generation ago. But I'm interested, obviously a lot of pilots we know were commissioned, and is the 9 o'clock news hour going to be grown from the pilots that you have undertaken, or is the format for that going to be completely something that's yet to evolve? And can you please reassure me that on a lean news day, it won't be six MSPs on sofas waffling for 20 minutes?
Mr. Carlow, as you've raised something which is not often raised, I better confess to you now, I was one of the editors on 60 Minutes.
Oh.
I don't say that to many people, but I'll say it to you. And that is also seared across my mind. You know, the tea time television is a delicate balance, and you've absolutely got to get it right. Looking at the pilots that were done by the teams in PQ, and they put a lot of energy into it. They really, really did well. There was one which I particularly liked on the second round of pilots, which was an hour, and it ended with a quarter of an hour of sports, and it really was very, very good. But look, I'm saying to Donalda and Gary and all the team in PQ, you know, now go play. You know, you think of what's going to really be compelling for viewers here. And there are very rare chances you have to kind of, reinvent the way we see broadcast news. But this could be one of them.
And what we can genuinely say is that these pilots have definitely informed how we will go about producing this news hour.
Thank you. Can I ask a question about the opt-outs currently on BBC Two? Because BBC Scotland opt-outs and BBC Two have very often been used to premiere key new commissioned BBC content the success of which, having then been judged, has often then led to it being networked across the whole of the UK, quite often on BBC One. But the opportunity to pilot that to a whole audience has been used through the mechanism of an opt-out in BBC Two. And I just wonder, I know it won't be your intention, but how will you ensure that UK network commissioning of BBC Scotland, of what has proved sometimes to be some outstanding, both drama and documentary, won't be prejudiced by removing the BBC Two opt-out?
I mean, Donalda, I'm sure you want to say something. I just want to say one thing. I think with BBC Scotland and the extra money we're putting in, and this is about quality programming, my hope is, and one of my tests will be, there'll be more on the network that started on BBC Scotland, a bit like the Grand Tour of the Highlands, which then ends up on BBC Two or BBC One for the whole of the UK. Because I want the whole of the UK to also be able to see the creativity and the programming that is coming from Scotland. But sorry, Donalda, you probably want to.
Yes, absolutely. So I think that opportunity is actually strengthened by us having this additional investment. I think what we will commission for BBC Scotland will inevitably find its way onto the networks, maybe not all of it, but I think that opportunity remains there, so that we will see commissions such as Tony mentioned, either Grand Tours of the Scottish Islands, translating over onto network, and many other, Field of Blood, for example, we've had a great comedy, whether Scott Squad, still to make that leap, but Two Doors Down, most recent example, we would expect that to continue in the context of the new channel.
Obviously something this committee will look at. And just finally, a technical question which follows on the EPN point. I mean, I am a big fan of BBC4, and I have to say, if you're saying that the costs of that currently include the kind of establishment and other operational costs, then I think there's a very broad range of programming delivered. So 30 million on programming alone for BBC Scotland is very encouraging. But will the EPN slot lead to BBC Four becoming a less obviously available channel in Scotland?
We need to negotiate with our partners. I'm sorry to on the various ways in which people get their television, and it depends very much on, you know, Sky versus Freeview versus Virgin, etc., etc. So I'm sorry, there's not a clear answer I can give you on that. What I do think is important, though, is that you know, when we market, we're making sure all the choices you've got, and leading people from, if it could be BBC One Scotland, to BBC Scotland, BBC Four, whatever. So,
all right, thank you.
Thank you.
Okay. Tavish?
Thank you very much. First, maybe I could start by agreeing with the broad premise of the welcome that's been for the proposals. Just in passing, please don't drop Match of the Day. As a Liverpool fan, I do not want to see Match of the Day lost in Scotland. You can drop Alan Shearer, but please don't drop the programme as a whole. Two questions. The first, on the point you made, Lord Hall, about £7 million in news. Do you envisage, and it's, I guess, also a question for Donalda, do you envisage the 9 o'clock news programme having access to John Soper in Washington, to Quentin Somerville in Syria, and so on and so forth?
Yes.
And your earlier point about how those journalists deal with News 24, now BBC Scotland, London, how do they fit all that into their... who will make the judgment about whether John Soper is on the 9 o'clock programme as opposed to then being on the 10 in 40 minutes' time?
Yeah, Scotland will make that decision between 9 and 10. So you've got to be clear about this. And it does mean that this programme will have access to John Soper or whatever they want to do. And I go back to something I said. We've got an enormous news gathering operation around the world. I say this to people in London too, I'd love to see more of it on the air. So my hope too is that Gary and the team in PQ will use some of that to do items and to do stories that actually are not appearing you know, the rest of the day on the BBC News Channel, or indeed on the 6 o'clock news or 10 o'clock news. So, but that whole, I mean, to your point, that network is absolutely available to them between 9 and 10. That's the priority.
Okay, thank you. And can I ask Donalda MacKinnon about radio? Because it's what's possibly not so clear out of the announcements that were made yesterday are the implications for radio. I mean, I would very strongly argue for the retention, indeed the enhancement of local radio stations, as Lewis MacDonald was arguing about Aberdeen. I'd make the same case about Shetland. And indeed our other local radio stations around Scotland. What are broadly the implications for radio in Scotland from yesterday's announcement, and how much more can be done?
So as I said yesterday, I don't think this is just about television. This is about an opportunity for all our services. And I see radio as being a very important part of all of that. I'm hugely proud of what we achieve in Radio Scotland, and indeed in Radio Shetland, Radio Orkney, Radio Ningale. I think we've got fantastic teams there. I think there is much more that we could do. I think with this additional investment in content, we need to work out how we extract as much value from that investment as possible. And I am pretty ambitious when it comes to radio. I've already said to teams that I would like to see us being able to provide audiences in Scotland with two English language radio services, two distinctive services, one speech, one music. I don't know if you managed to catch any of our pilot, Radio Scotland Extra, Music Extra, which we launched 8 days before St Andrew's Day and ran across that period. I think that proved to us that we could offer something really quite precious. I really want to explore the possibilities of being able to deliver that. Obviously, that would require various approvals, but I'm keen to begin to explore that with colleagues in BBC Scotland.
Thank you.
Thank you. Rachel Hamilton.
Thank you. I think it's great that that Scottish people will get better value for their licence fee. I just wanted to really have a supplementary question to Jackson, because could you explain further how you're going to provide a service that is distinct from others, because we're in a situation where we could have almost overload?
I think, let me do the top point and then maybe Donald and Ken would like to come in on that. I thought one of the good things, actually, of the charter debate was this sort of sense of people not wanting to push the BBC into a model, as in the States, where you become a tiny channel just doing things that other people wouldn't do, recognising that that the breadth of the audience, good things for everybody, was at the heart of the BBC, but that those things should be overall distinctive. And I think that's a good creative challenge to the BBC. I think you see distinctiveness in the drama that we can offer. I think the fact that you see docs about the prison service, for example, right in the heart of the schedule, I think that's distinctive. And I think taking risks and bringing on new talent is also part of that distinctiveness. And I spent a little bit of time yesterday with the social at Pacific Quay, where that in an online social media world is finding new talent and giving them voice. And I think that's part of what I hope this service will give to Scotland, which is finding new talent, giving it voice, giving it an opportunity. And that's part of what I think is our distinctiveness should be. But Donalda, you may want to say others.
And I guess, what we're basing this on and what we're trying to address here is a perception that Scotland's is not representing BBC Scotland has not been able to adequately represent what audiences have been asking us to do. So audiences have consistently said they want to see more of their lives reflected on screen in all the various across every genre, from drama through to factual through to entertainment. So this is set up to address that. I would say also we have quite often commissioned fantastic programmes that audiences still find quite hard to find on BBC One and BBC Two, just because of the volume of other content that surrounds them. So for the first time, I think we'll have an opportunity to address that, notwithstanding that we will leave fantastic content still on BBC One.
Okay, thank you. Hey, Ross Green.
Like others, I very much welcome yesterday's announcement. I had the novel experience of being live on the BBC yesterday afternoon, being asked to criticise the BBC by the BBC, because we'd reached this cross-party consensus and it wasn't a very interesting discussion that we were having on Politics Scotland. But one area that I noticed, as an NUJ member, I was delighted by the headline announcement of 80 new jobs for journalists. Some concerns have been raised with me about technical staff. I was wondering if you could confirm what new technical staff will be brought on board, because it was existing members of staff at PQ came to me with some concerns that they were going to be overstretched because they noticed that they weren't really part of this announcement of new capacity being added to their teams.
We specifically only mentioned the journalist jobs, but there will be many more jobs that will accrue from this, as you say, from the technical, but also in the general production. We didn't wish to put a number on that because that would depend a lot on the genres that are commissioned by Donalda and the leadership of the channel. I think in terms of supporting the channel, one of the points that I wish to make is that not only is there a great sense of excitement, aspiration in BBC Scotland, but also in the independent sector as well. And I think that the channel can provide, with the technical resources which are required, a great focus and a forum for Scotland. It will give us the space to have a real set of partnerships where we can, whether that's the National Theatre, whether it's in music or with all the various creative institutions, Creative Scotland, in that are at play in the nation, a real opportunity to deliver something that's really special. But I want to make another point, which is that although Donalda and her team and all the community in Scotland are excited by this, so are all my colleagues across the whole of the BBC in every single division, whether that's research and development, whether it's online. James Harding and News, absolutely four square behind the success of this channel. Charlotte Moore and content, everybody is absolutely backing and willing the success of this channel, not only with a resource but with a commitment. And it's just a wonderful sense of potential and possibility that we have at this time. I think in terms of the talent that we have coming through, we've seen through our apprentices schemes that the technical staff are coming through. We've got a generation hugely skilled in digital media available and standing ready to support the channel.
I think the question would be about having enough, I no doubt, but the talent of the people that are there, it's the capacity, the people that are already there, that's not enough for what will be required for this new channel.
We'll certainly have to recruit to support the channel, without question.
Thank you.
Thank you. Emma Harper.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, everybody. I think I welcome a new TV channel. I think that's great news. I am concerned that 30 million won't really stretch very far. I'm just wondering about our new hour-long news programme at 9 o'clock. Can you guarantee that this programme would get access to international reporters in the same way that the BBC does at 6 p.m?
Absolutely. And as Ken just said, James Harding, the Director of News, has been intimately, closely involved in this whole proposition. And he's guaranteeing that, I'm guaranteeing that. That's absolutely the aim, is to put the entire resources of the BBC, nationally, internationally, and in Scotland, behind this news hour.
Okay. Okay. Do any other members have specific questions about the new channel? Stuart?
Good morning, panel. I think, like all colleagues, I genuinely welcome the announcement yesterday, and I think it certainly will create new opportunities in terms of programming, but also in terms of employment, and that can only be a good thing, because I think, as you quite rightly have stated, there is a huge amount of talent, creative talent in Scotland. But I've got a couple of questions, certainly in terms of further detail. The first one is regarding BBC Alba. Now, the additional £1.2 million, I think, certainly is welcomed as well, but it still doesn't put that channel on a par with the S4C in Wales. So will there be any scope for any additional investment into BBC Alba going forward?
So I'll leave Kenny to answer the question about S4C in Wales, just to say that, you know, currently we invest £5.5 million in BBC Alba. We are now taking on the responsibility of funding £1.2 million worth of content that we were producing, paid for by MG Alba. So that has allowed us the opportunity, or has allowed the commissioning team around BBC Alba to commission extra content from around the country. What we are seeing by launching this new channel, by this new reinvestment, that there will be obvious benefits that will accrue for BBC Alba and for Radio Na Gael. We estimate that we'll be able to offer an additional 100 hours of originated programming to the service. We currently offer 4.2 hours of origination a week. We would like to see that over the next 3 years increase to by 3 hours to 7.2. So although the ask has been for us to provide 10 hours of origination, we're fairly confident that we can reach 7.2 and, where possible, extend that even further. And where we have opportunities to invest, whether around anniversaries, around elections, around major events, we will always take account of the fact that we need to invest in BBC Alba and in Radio Na Gael at the same time. And again, I would just like to emphasise the importance of having launched BBC Alba in terms of that experience and the learning that it provides us, how how absolutely powerful that is in terms of what we're going to be able to do with this channel. I see these two channels working hand in glove, so I see the opportunities for BBC Alba as immense.
Okay. So I take it it was something that would certainly be under review, make it on a continual review basis.
Absolutely.
If there is any additional resource. Okay, thank you. In terms of the 9 o'clock to 10 o'clock news programme, I'm young enough to remember that the news used to be at 9 o'clock and then it was changed to 10 p.m. And from memory, I might be wrong in this, and you can tell me if I am. But I'm sure that one of the reasons for it was because of other programming, and with the news seemed to split up the potential kind of drama programmes, so it was put on to 10 o'clock. To make that make less of that break in programming. So with the 9 o'clock till 10 p.m. Slot to be taken as a news hour, will that, do you anticipate that that's actually going to have a high viewership, or do you think that if there are good drama programmes or good programmes on the other channels, then it's actually the 9 to 10 slot is doomed to fail?
I used to edit the 9 o'clock news a very long time ago, and in fact was part of the discussions which moved it to 10. I think there's the 9 o'clock is the point when the audience, the available audience, is very high indeed. So it's a good point to try to capture audiences in the evening. And I think what you're also seeing now is, in terms of drama and other things to watch, people are also using catch-up. So they might go live and then use catch-up to go and see things that they might be playing on other channels. So I think there's a terrific chance here to do something which actually will really capture people's imaginations and viewership. A lot of that depends on, I go back to EPG position, to the rest of the content, etc. But I think this is a good positioning for a news programme. And we're adding to choice that viewers in Scotland have, not trying to compete against somebody else, say at 7 or another time. So I'm confident about this.
Can we move on now?
I've got one more.
Right. Very briefly.
Right. In terms of the news content, with the 9 to 10 slot, and obviously with the focus will be, the editorial content coming obviously from Scotland, do you see that actually having a knock-on effect to the 6 p.m. news, which is obviously UK network, in terms of even more non-Scottish-based content in that particular slot?
Well, for a start, there'll be a much greater news-gathering operation in Scotland, and I think that will benefit all of our services. So far from it detracting from what we're offering at 6 o'clock, I think it offers potential, further potential for 6 to half 6 to reflect Scotland better, potentially. And indeed, it will probably enhance reporting Scotland as well. So I do think that this is a win-win. And as Tony said, it is about extending choice. We have our highest audience numbers around about 9 o'clock, so I think we've given it the best chance that I think we possibly can. It's not competing with any other news programme. It will have access to the foreign correspondents because there is no other requirement other than the 10, admittedly. So I think this is enhancing our offer and absolutely extending choice.
Thank you very much. Can we move on now? Because there's a number of important issues that we need to talk about in terms of the charter and some of the evidence that the committee's gathered in the past. Most notably, that is evidence from the independent production sector in Scotland and the concern of the phenomenon of lift and shift, whereby you meet your targets for Scottish production with production companies that aren't actually really based here in Scotland. So can I ask you, what steps the BBC is taking to ensure that the majority of the 8.6% Scottish target for original network programme is made by Scottish companies and produced by Scottish-based talent?
First of all, across the BBC, across the nations and regions, we have new portrayal targets, which will make sure that the stories we tell are absolutely representative of that. In terms of what we want to do, we want to grow from the ground in all of the nations of the UK, and to have the best content we possibly can airing not only in the UK but across the world. In terms of the areas of lift and shift that we've discussed, we have an assurance process whereby that there is a mechanism to go to Ofcom with any challenge, you know, on any of the programmes that we're designating. Ultimately, we work within the Ofcom rules as far as that's concerned. But in terms of the spirit of what this committee wants to see delivered, we're absolutely...
That doesn't sound as if you're doing anything new.
Well, I think in terms of that all of what we've put in place, in terms of the commissioners we've put in place on the ground, in terms of the access, in terms of the writers' rooms, in terms of the money that we're putting into development, we've created a new portrayal fund of £2 million to ensure that we foster and enhance portrayal. All of these are new measures designed to ensure that on the ground, okay, that we're producing
so
the ideas.
What should the minimum requirement be for a company qualifying as a Scottish company that, you know, would contribute to this quota? What should be the minimum requirement?
The Ofcom criteria, which we abide by, is substantive base, 70% of the spend in Scotland, and if I recall, half the production team should come from Scotland as well, and that's what we abide with. But listen, I think what's going on here is to get to our targets in the past, we've moved as much as we can to Scotland, which actually has produced jobs. You know, I mean the snooker example, which you know, I've been looking at, because I know again this is something which concerns you. At least those are jobs for Scots, even though they're actually working in Sheffield, and that does sound odd. But look, I think what we're trying to do is to get away from that and say, actually, what we're committing to now is working with the indie sector here, working with BBC Studios here, to ensure that we're growing the creative base of Scotland in Scotland with, you know, Scots creativity. And I think we've you know, I think we're in a different part of the development and what we're trying to do in Scotland.
Yeah, it's just I'm pushing the point because obviously we've had a lot of correspondence on this. It's come up not just in this committee but in the previous Economy Committee.
Yeah.
And I just wanted to read out to you something that an independent producer had sent to us in relation to your commissioning, because you've made a big play of these new commissioners.
Yeah.
But this independent producer has said, you know, network programming budgets are now 100% controlled in London by channel controllers of BBC One, BBC Two, BBC Three and BBC Four. And these four individuals who are named are the only commissioners that can greenlight projects for the BBC network. Everyone else, anyone they tell you is based in Scotland, is not a commissioner. Though they may help you on the road to a commission, they're not empowered to buy programmes for the BBC. So this independent producer goes on to say, so if the BBC won't devolve this power to commission to individuals based here, they should at the very least require to allocate the spend in Scotland in line with our national licence fee revenue. For example, these allocations should apply to BBC One, BBC Two, BBC Three, BBC Four, and they should cover drama, comedy, documentary, arts, entertainment, etc. I thought that was really quite a strong point to make, that you can talk about having commissioners in Scotland, but the power is still with these four individuals in London.
I think that's not how I understand I see the commissioning system working. These are powerful voices in Scotland, working with the teams that look at the whole of the UK and what we're doing, for example, in drama, or what we're doing in science, or what we're doing in arts, or what we're doing anything. So, you know, making television across the network is a collaboration. And what I want to ensure is that the voices of Scotland are absolutely there at that table when decisions are made about do we do this or that or whatever. That's one thing. So I think, you know, those commissioners based in Scotland being part of that conversation is really important. The second thing, though, is that we are holding our networks, as you know, to strict goals in terms of the amount we expect to come out of Scotland and indeed Wales and indeed Northern Ireland. So there's a kind of a double thing going on there. I think being in the conversation and being part of the discussion and debate is really important. That's a creative discussion, but you're also having to argue or make sure we're delivering against targets. And what we're doing this year is over-delivering against that, which I think is really good. And that shows the power, actually, of influencing power, but real power that the commissioners
have
got.
But who is the green light? Is it these four individuals, Charlotte Moore, Patrick Holland, Damien Kavanagh and Cassian Harrison, is it these four channel controllers that have the green light?
Well, the channel controllers, in the end, are the people who say yay and nay. But let me tell you, making television is not just a question of you know, I'm going to sit there on my pedestal and decide that, that and the other. It really is about a conversation, about a debate, about what creatively we're trying to do. And what I want to make sure is that the voice of Scotland through those commissioners are absolutely there at the core of that debate. And I believe they are increasingly, which is why you see the upturn in terms of what we're commissioning and doing from Scotland. Yeah. It's working.
Do all the commissioners you have in Scotland live in Scotland?
I think so. I'm...
The Comedy Commissioner lives in Scotland. Factual Commissioner lives in Scotland. Children's Commissioner lives in Scotland. Yeah. The Acting Drama Commissioner lives in Scotland.
Okay.
Entertainment, Daytime and Entertainment Commissioners both live in Scotland too.
Okay. Ross Greer.
On Donalda MacKinnon's last point around the commissioners, I'd had some contact, and I should say, I'm about to talk about the Acting Drama Commissioner. I've not met the individual who has that post at the moment, so it's not them who contacted me. But there was some concern that the new role that person will have to apply for, that the role that will replace that, seems to be based 3 days a week in London. Is that the case?
Do you want to answer that, Kenny? There are three nations.
I've got the job description.
In terms of, obviously, with an appointments process at the moment, there's a, certainly, you know, in terms of the time they would spend, you know, for example, Stephen Wright, who is the from BBC Northern Ireland, would spend time in Northern Ireland where he lives, but also time in London. They will be back and forth, you know, depending on what appointment is actually made.
But if you're spending most of your week, most of your working week in London, is that really a Scottish-based job? Is that really Drama Commissioner for Scotland?
The person, you know, who is appointed, and we're in the middle of an appointments process at the moment, so I wouldn't wish to say too much about that, but will be in Scotland to absolutely effect the role that they've been designated to do. And they will build the connections, will be here. How they divide their time will be between themselves and obviously their head of department.
I think what will be really important is I don't think we can be prescriptive about how much time any individual should spend in London or indeed anywhere around the UK. If these jobs are Scotland-facing jobs, then obviously there has to be a critical amount of time that they absolutely spend here. However, in order to be part of these collaborative conversations around what is right to sit on any given channel or to fulfil our commitments, then they have to be part of that conversation too. So presence in London is important, but I take your point. I don't think we should be prescriptive about the amount of time a person has to spend there.
Do you accept the point that this is often where concern about lift and shift reoccurring comes from, when you have Scottish posts, and I don't mean to sound particularly parochial about it, but when you have Scottish posts that are in fact largely based in London, that can be where issues of lift and shift come from, because they are familiar with independent production companies based down south who they can commission to do work in Scotland.
I don't see how you can do your job properly unless you're based here and spending a huge amount of time here. You know, the whole thing about having these commissioners is they're outside talking to people, working out ideas, talking to people in Scotland, all over Scotland, finding out new talent, working out with existing talent what we can do. That's the job, isn't it? That's the job, to be out there. So I don't see how you can do that by any other means and by being here for a substantial amount of time. But of course, you also want to go and argue your corner with the drama commissioner in London, the head of drama in London, so you've got to spend some time, I guess, on Virgin trains or the plane. But, you know, you've got to be doing your job here, getting out there and getting around the place, you know, finding the new ideas.
Yeah, I think that point about balance, I think, is the key point, rather than the concerns that have been raised about spending the majority of your working week outside the area that you should be representing and advocating for.
Mm.
Thank you, Lewis MacDonald.
Thank you very much. You've talked about the BBC family this morning and the Screen Sector Leadership Group, which produced a report recently in Scotland, chaired by John McCormick. They talked about ensuring that there was a Scottish voice, not just in commissioning of programmes here in Scotland, but within the network. And I wonder if in addition to the commissioner posts that we've heard about, what your thoughts are around commissioning for the network specifically going forward.
I mean, the voice we've now got right at the centre of the BBC, having Kenny there, you know, with his broad remit over all nations and regions, I think is phenomenally important for ensuring that the voice of Scotland, but also Wales, Northern Ireland and England is heard at the very, very top table. And I hope this answers your point, Mr. McDonald, but I did that because one of our public purposes, the new public purpose, is to make sure we're committed to the nations and regions, and that's what Ken's job is, which means for the first time in the time I've been back at the BBC, which is nearly 4 years, the national and regional English voice is absolutely there in all our discussions. And, you know, Ken makes his views heard very, very powerfully on that. And I think that's a big change in the way that the top of the BBC sees our commitment, not just to Scotland, but other nations as well.
That's helpful. One of the other commitments I know you've made in the past has been around service license agreements and ensuring a devolution of decision-making within the BBC to BBC Scotland. And I wonder if you could update us on where that lies.
I can. I mean, that is still my view, but I hope you understand. I've now got a new chair. I'm delighted that Sir David Clemente is joining as the chair of the BBC. I've long believed, as you may have seen from other evidence here, but elsewhere too, believed in the BBC having a unitary board. You know, how we now organise ourselves is very, very much his prerogative and not mine, though, of course, I'll be recommending things to him. But I think the, you know, if you just look at the things that we announced yesterday, I mean, BBC Scotland Channel, that's Donalda's in her bailiwick, and she's got to kind of get on with it with the right metrics and so on. I mean, that is, I hope, an element of clear devolution of responsibilities.
That's very helpful. We talked a little earlier about ALIPA, and clearly Ken MacQuarrie, with an overview of the nations and regions, will see that in the context of the BBC family as a whole. I wonder, for example, in relation to broadcasting in Wales and some of the issues that have been raised around that, whether Ken MacQuarrie would like to say something about how he sees what the vision is, if you like, not just within BBC Scotland, but within the BBC as a whole, for the future of Gaelic language broadcasting, both on radio and television.
I think there's a very exciting opportunity within the new division of nations and regions, where clearly directors Donalda here in Scotland and Rodri in Wales and Peter in Northern Ireland will address their own audiences, their specific needs. But there's a great opportunity to bring together the nations and the regions to work together, because each has a pot of funding. I think there's a tremendous the richness in terms of the ideas that can be exchanged, different ways of working and different approaches. And I think within that, BBC ALIPA can absolutely benefit from that. And I would envisage also that we will go further, that outside the BBC, and build relationships with other broadcasters, be that TG Care, for example, in Ireland, or be it indeed in the South, or RTE. And I think that within all of the if you like, the potential for creativity, for conversations, BBC ALIPA will absolutely benefit from that. And indeed will benefit from every single investment that the BBC make, as we showed with iPlayer, but with every other investment, we will absolutely set out to make sure that every time we spend a public pound, that the maximum value is derived from it.
Thank you very much.
Okay, Richard Lockhead.
Thanks. I just wonder if you can say a little bit more about the commissioning process. I'm trying to get my head around how the sort of relationship works between the creative sectors in Scotland and the BBC, and to what extent you set down challenges for the creative sector to come back with ideas, or to what extent they come to you with ideas, and, you know, how all that relationship works.
So it can be both. So depending on which service it is, different commissioners operate slightly different ways of working. I think with the setting up of BBC Studios, we have absolutely had to look at all of that, and we hope to be communicating with the independent production sector in Scotland, myself and my colleague Alan Dixon behind me, next Wednesday, just outlining how we plan to organise the commissioning process for Scotland. going forward. I think our Commissioner for Television has tended to operate on a rolling commissioning basis, so there will be briefs provided, but then there's an expectation that, that producers, production companies, in-house production will develop ideas to meet some of these briefs, or indeed come up with ideas that the Commissioner perhaps hadn't thought of. In any creative process, I think it's important that you have a bit of a mix of that. What we are going to have to do now, though, is prepare ourselves for this new contestability framework where our transparency around commissioning becomes even more acutely important. And that's what we plan to communicate to the sector on Wednesday, and indeed to in-house teams as well, so that everybody feels that they are operating on a level playing field, that they've got as much access, that there is transparency and accountability, as I said, around everything that we do. I think that's very important.
So if in 3 or 4 or 5 years we were to have the Killing or the Bridge or Borgen coming from Scotland, the equivalent, how do you think that's best? How can that best happen?
I think we already have many ideas in train for and aspirations to that effect, to achieve that kind of level of drama production in Scotland. But if I could say, I think in many ways we are already there. I think we have a returning brand in Shetland. I think it's a fantastic series. I also think that on a whole lot of other fronts, we produce fantastic content on a daily basis. Look out for The Replacement, which hits our screens next Tuesday on BBC One. We've also got a brand new drama set here in Edinburgh called Cleek, which will air on the 5th of March on BBC Three. So we're already there. I just think that we have now got an even better opportunity, a bigger opportunity, to explore some of that creativity even further and ensure that that critical mass that we've all longed for will exist.
On that subject, a number of parties have raised concerns with the committees about the BBC studios and whether there really will be a level playing field for Scottish producers, whether the BBC studios fits the Scottish model. How are you going to ensure that the tender process, gives Scottish independent producers a fair crack of the whip when you're competing?
I mean, the new board, I mean, under existing arrangements, the BBC Trust and our fair trading guidelines ensure that there is a level playing field. We've begun a tendering process at the moment with three programmes out to tender, and there is a level playing field between studios and between indies. With a unitary board, their job, their responsibility is to make sure that level playing field carries on. Ofcom, as our new regulator from April 1st, also have the duty to ensure that we're doing that properly as well. So there's an awful lot of checks on us to make sure that that we're doing this properly. But can I just turn the argument round? What I saw was in-house production, which I believe in, gradually diminishing right across the piece. And I, by setting up studios, the team and myself wanted to release some of the ideas that in-house said, well, look, I've got this idea, it's been turned down by BBC One, now I can do nothing. And to say, all right, if the government are going to say to us, we want to make sure that you open up all your airwaves to competition between in-house production and indies, which I happen to think is the right thing, we want to get the best of the independent sector with the best of our in-house, then you've got to make sure equally that the in-house can compete properly. And that's been... I've got great confidence in our in-house producers. It's been difficult because we've had to make redundant some people. It's hard to do that. I would rather we didn't have to do that. But I've got a lot of confidence in our in-house teams, or studios teams, we now would call them, here in Scotland, but also elsewhere around the UK, to really push forward some exciting and good ideas. I didn't want to see gradual decline for any of our production base in-house. I wanted to see the chance of it growing, and that's down to our ideas now.
Okay, Jackson Carlisle.
Yes, a single question really on the fact you now have BBC Studios. You're looking at 60% new commissioning of programming, which will go beyond and into the independent sector. However, does that also represent a challenge to Scottish Government, Scottish Enterprise, Creative Scotland? Because it does seem to me that Northern Ireland Screen and Wales have been more advanced in the development of studio capacity There seem to be lots of concerns about available studio capacity in Scotland, and I just wonder, you may be creating all these opportunities, and while documentaries don't particularly need studio capacity, we need to ensure that the enterprise agencies and the Scottish Government are ensuring that Scotland is in a place to actually take advantage of the opportunity you're creating.
I think the Northern Ireland screen model has been a particularly the powerful model. I've met with Richard Williams in Northern Ireland. We'll be meeting with him again shortly. I think that in Scotland there's now an opportunity for all of the creative agencies to come together to make sure that the commitments that we're making in terms of our spend unleashes the maximum potential. And I think the McCormick, John McCormick's report, you know, sort of indicates where we could go with there. And I would like to see in all of the nations strong competitive screen agencies and Scotland competing equally in that regard.
Can I ask about digital services? Because I think, Lord Hall, you were asked about this a year ago when you were in front of the previous committee. And obviously the BBC moved BBC Three onto digital last year. There's a recent Ofcom report that shows only 46% of properties, in other words, houses across Scotland, actually can get super fast broadband. So my concern as a member representing a very rural part of it, I'm grateful for the plug for Shetland that you've made a number of times this morning. I can exclusively reveal I've been asked to be an extra, but I'm going to turn it down. So there we are. You don't need me on television for any way whatsoever. I rest my case. But can I, on digital rollout, can I ask what the BBC are doing to recognise that many parts of Scotland, indeed many parts of the UK, have the challenges of superfast broadband, and therefore if you put more onto digital, people can't access as much BBC programming?
Yep. Yes, we've absolutely recognised, you know, that there is an imbalance in terms of the availability of, if you like, high-speed broadband. Yeah. And I think that where we're certainly interested in getting involved is in conversations with all the stakeholders in this regard, from BBC Online, BBC R&D. I know it's something that Matthew Postgate, who leads that area, is particularly interested in that, and we would be happy to sit down, identify where the needs are, and be part of that conversation.
So it's ongoing work in that sense.
Yeah, what the BBC offers through iPlayer and all that sort of stuff is an incentive to go online and to get broadband, and if we can in any way help the conversation of getting more broadband to more people, we're up for that.
Yeah, thank you.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you. On that subject, can you just tell us where you are with the Scotland homepage?
So part of the proposals that we announced yesterday, and part of the investment that we announced, will go into Scotland digital editions, so of our news and sport pages, but that will also contribute to reimagining the homepage.
Right. Do you have a deadline for that?
Well, that work is ongoing at the moment.
Right, okay. Because it's something you spoke about when you gave evidence last year.
One of the big pushes we're having is to get people to sign in to iPlayer and online as well, because this is not about the homepage, this is about our big push over the next year or two. We want to get people to sign in so we know who they are and where they are, and then we can begin to suggest content to them that suits either the geography, where they are, or their interests. We've called it My BBC. I think I talked about that last time.
Yes,
I was here.
Yeah.
We're making sure that we get people to sign in voluntarily at the moment, but there's going to be a point at some point in the next year when we'll make it mandatory. And at that point, when we've got data about people, we can then begin to serve them even better with things that are particular to them. And I think, although the homepage is important, it really is, I think the notion that we know you're in Scotland, here's your news about Scotland, but actually here's the latest of X or Y or BBC Scotland, whatever, I think it's going to be a big breakthrough to serving people better as well.
Right. And is there, just to clarify, there is going to be additional investment in digital journalism?
Yes.
There is?
Yeah.
Yes.
Absolutely.
Okay. Emma Harper.
Thank you, Convener. There's a lot of money spent on ALBA, and I'm curious about seeing more programmes on Scots language, like more, not just comedy, more drama, maybe children's programmes, educational programmes, using Urien Scots lead.
I agree with you. I think we do encourage as much of Scots language to appear across our output. And the Scots language, of course, has many expressions across Scotland, as I'm sure you know. And what we try to do is we try to reflect that range in some of our output. So in programmes like the Mart, the River, Fair Isle, Sighthill, Grand Tours, we do that on television. On radio, we encourage our on-air talent to use the Scots language as much as they can. We've also just broadcast fairly recently a three-parter on Burns. Can't remember exactly what the title of it was, but it was something about the rock and roll life of Robert Burns. We've also, Billy Kay has made many an important series for us, but recently he updated that fantastic series called The Scots Tongue. So we are very committed to reflecting the Scots language where and when we can.
Okay, thanks very much, Stuart McMillan.
Thank you. Earlier on this morning, Lord Hall, you spoke about the announcement yesterday and the new channel. You spoke about also the new talent, the opportunities, and also the potential for taking risks in terms of some of the commissioning. But with that in mind, has there been a culture of commissioning editors potentially being risk averse when commissioning from companies that they've possibly not worked with before?
I'd prefer to put it more positively. I think it goes back to the question asked by Ms. Hamilton about distinctiveness, which I think is the right question. I think because of the way we're funded, I think we can afford and should afford to take more risks, to commission things we're not sure they're going to work, to make sure that we give them every possible chance to work, but which might be more edgy, might break new ground, might feel that we're not following but we're actually leading. And that's why it goes back again to the important role of commissioners as well as the people who are doing the production of this content, that we kind of make that part of our of what we're about. Because you know, when I took and the Scottish Parliament have been very helpful, this, you know, an 11-year charter gives us the confidence to say, you know, we know we're going to exist for the next 11 years. And I think that therefore in how we commission and how the programmes we do should show that confidence. And I don't want programmes to fail. But I do want, if somebody said to me, that was great you took that risk, it didn't quite work, did it, but well done for doing it, I'm also content, you know, because I think I want us to break new ground.
But I also think, Tony might have mentioned, the social, which is, I would draw your attention to it. If you haven't consumed any of it, I would urge you to do so. I think it is an example of where we've become particularly innovative in that digital sphere. I think what they do in terms of curating and commissioning content from producers who are mostly young from across this country, their emphasis is heavily on diversity. Mm. It's short form, admittedly, but I think there's just something in that model that we could possibly translate into this new service. But I also just think about it just in terms of what they're doing in sourcing new talent, in surfacing new kinds of production, new approaches. I think it's probably one of the most innovative models that probably exists across the BBC.
I mean, I talked yesterday to a brilliant young woman. She's at university. She said, I never knew I could do this. I'm being supported here by the BBC to do to make things, and I'm so excited, and I've learned a whole direction for my career. There's also, by the way, there's a yoga in kilts, which is an interesting little short video which they've made too, which is terrific actually, and really beautifully done. They were talking yesterday, which I think is right, at Pacific Quay, and saying, is this something we could franchise across the whole of the BBC? Because it really is drilling into that next generation of people and seeing how they can take public service broadcasting on and giving them a chance to do things which are exciting and I hope are going to kind of change their lives. I'm so impressed by the social.
Check out the three-year-old's views on Valentine's Day as well. That's a corker. But also, can I just say, I also look at what we do in children's, not just in Scotland, but in Salford as well. I think what they do is particularly innovative. And also, I think we should look to our learning departments as well. And just to go back to your question about Scots language, I think what they've done there in terms of materials that they provide in the Scots language for schools has been hugely important and, again, very creative.
So yoga in kilts. Although, as a politician, I hesitated before sharing it on Facebook. Sorry, did I interrupt you, Mr. McMillan?
Yeah, no, indeed. I'm not aware of this particular programme, so, and I don't know if I want to actually, but we'll see. No, it's, in terms of the commissioning, in terms of the commissioning, certainly in recent years, but also with this opportunity going forward with the new charter, how much focus or what type of drive will there be to encourage the commissioning editors? To certainly look at Scotland in terms of what actually has been produced. I mean, also a couple of examples just been spoken about there, but to look at Scotland and also with the new channel as well announced yesterday, and with the additional employment and opportunities that will be created.
So well, the drive's coming from me, and it's coming from Ken as well. But as Donalda was saying, and I think I was trying to say too, I think doing is the most wonderful thing. And what we did yesterday is to say, look, you've now got this channel to do exciting things on. And one of the things we kind of know, and you've seen it with some of the opt-out programmes from BBC Two, is when people see something good and they say, well, that's terrific, and it's been commissioned in Scotland, we'll also make sure that goes across the UK. And it's something you were making a point about earlier on. I think we now have an even bigger palette to do programming, to do new things, to things from Scotland, which I then, my aim is to get as many of those to go right across the network as we can.
On the way to deliver that, obviously there's been talk of the service level agreement as a way of delivering that, making sure that we get more programmes made in Scotland for the network. Has that service level agreement been finalised, and can you tell us a little bit about it?
No, that's the work of the new unitary board, which comes in on April the 3rd. So when that board is there, they've got to work out how we're going to be governed in that sort of way. Ofcom will, of course, have a view across the totality of what we're doing as well, and set us targets and quotas on that as well. But, you know, I just go back. What we announced yesterday is spending in Scotland is under Donalda's purview, and so, you know, it's up to her to deliver against that.
Right. And you had discussions with Ofcom about the operating framework and how...
Those
how
are things.
Those
are discussions which are going on at the moment. I know you're hearing from Ofcom later.
Yeah.
I mean, it's probably, you know, they're now they're about to be our regulator. It's far better that they say how they're going to regulate us than I hazard a guess.
Well, we've run out of time now. I know that you were earlier asked about the Screen Sector Leadership Group, and we've probably not gone into their report perhaps in the detail that we should have. But just to finish off, one of the key recommendations of that report is that you should have a five-year strategy to getting up to 100% of the licence fee being spent in Scotland. Are you going to adopt that recommendation by the Screen
well,
Sector Leadership
we've
Group?
Laid out where we're going for the next 3 years. I said that, you know, we're to use that analogy, I always hate a journey, but we're making progress. You know, we continue to make progress. The question I think we've all got to ask wherever we are across the UK is that if you get to the point where 100% of all the licence fee raised in Scotland is spent in Scotland, 100% is done, you know, in Wales, Northern Ireland, North of England, and so on, you begin to lose the unity of the BBC, you know. And the question I think we've all got to ask ourselves is, what are we paying towards the fact of having a brilliant world service, having a BBC One that has amazing sports, all these things which we get by being together? And there's a price to that. So don't take from that any unwillingness on my part to keep pushing to get more for Scotland, but you do have to consider, I also have to consider what it is that Scotland, London, Ashbourne, anywhere, are all paying to get the totality of our output in the way we all want it to be and enjoy. So
right.
it's a balance, convener.
Yes. So you're saying that you're not going to adopt that recommendation?
I'm saying we've laid out where we are for the next 3 years. I'm clear where we are going for the next 3 years, and as that goes on, we'll decide more of what we want to do.
Okay, thank you very much for coming to give evidence to us today. And perhaps you could maybe give an undertaking to come back to the committee at a later point once your plans are further developed.
Very, very happy to come back, convener.
Okay,
thank you very
thank
much
you
for the
very
invitation.
Much.
Thank you.
We'll have a short suspension. Okay. We now continue the evidence session and I welcome Glenn Preston, Director Scotland for Ofcom, and Kevin Bakhurst, Group Director of Content Policy with Ofcom. I understand that Ofcom will commence its new regulatory role with regard to the BBC in April, so this session will focus on Ofcom's consultation work to date and approach to going forward. And I'd like to invite Glenn Preston to make an opening statement.
Thanks, Kavira. I think Kevin's actually going to do the opening statement, if that's okay with you, as our Group Director for Content and Media Policy. May I just say a couple of quick words just about Ofcom in Scotland, just to set some of the context as well. We're growing in Scotland. A number of you will probably be familiar with the background to Ofcom. We had about 5 people in Scotland from 2003 up until last summer. As part of an out-of-London strategy, which is really focused also on recognising the big shift in constitutional and political landscape, particularly in Scotland, we have about 24 people in the Ofcom office based in Princes Street in Edinburgh now, some of which are on the content standards and policy side in Kevin's group, who will be focusing on the sorts of BBC regulation issues that you were just discussing and that we will discuss as the new regulator from the 3rd of April. So I hope it's helpful just to have that kind of context there, and then I'll pass over to Kevin.
Thank you, Convener. I'll try and be brief because I know you're time limited here. So thank you very much for the invitation to appear before the committee today and for this opportunity to make some short opening remarks. The Scottish Parliament Information Centre briefing today for today's session has done a very good job at outlining the background to the renewal of the BBC Charter and Agreement and Ofcom's current and future responsibilities. I hope it's useful briefly for me to outline where things are from Ofcom's perspective. In December, we published a document about our preparations for assuming our new responsibilities. That noted the new Charter and Agreement represent the biggest reform of the governance and regulation agreements of the BBC since it was founded. As the new external regulator, Ofcom brings scale and experience in certain areas of public service broadcasting delivery, as well as the value of its overview of the whole broadcast and communications sector at a time of increasing convergence, interconnectedness and change. Under the new charter, the BBC board and Ofcom will have distinct roles in line with the Clementi Review's recommendation that governance and regulation should be separated. The charter makes it clear that the board of the BBC is responsible for the exercise of all of the functions of the BBC in accordance with the provisions set out in the Charter and Agreement. It will be for the BBC board to ensure that the BBC acts in the public interest and meets its wider charter obligations, continuing to oversee strategy, service delivery and efficiency. Our role at Ofcom is to set regulatory requirements that the BBC must meet in respect of programmes and services to ensure the BBC's actions don't have a disproportionate impact on fair and effective competition, and to hold the BBC to account where it fails to comply with its obligations. In carrying out our role, we'll have robust enforcement powers. We view this as a clean break with the old regime. As the committee is well aware, the BBC Trust was responsible for both governance and regulation. Ofcom's new role will be different. The regulatory system we construct will reflect our position as an independent external regulator and our experience of regulating the entire broadcasting sector. The BBC's independence from government is recognised in the Charter, and Ofcom is independent of government and independent of the organisations it regulates. The BBC must have the space to take creative risks and choose how it organises itself, provided it continues to comply with its overarching duties, without the regulator involved in its creative decision-making, scheduling decisions or management structures. The operating licence that we set for the BBC will reflect and respect the separation of responsibilities. The Charter and Agreement requires Ofcom to issue an operating framework setting out exactly how it will regulate the BBC. We are committed to developing a clear, efficient and easy to understand framework for BBC regulation. The Charter and Agreement define Ofcom's role in 3 main areas: content standards, competition and performance. The operating framework will set out the regulatory tools that Ofcom will use to hold the BBC to account in these areas. We are consulting, and we have been for some weeks, on the detail of our role, and we'll set it out in an overall operating framework. This will build on a series of the initial consultations that are recently closed. These consultations are well summarised in the Spice Note, but I draw the committee's attention specifically to the Broadcasting Code Review, which will see the application of the existing broadcasting code in full to BBC broadcasting series services and, where relevant, on-demand programme services. Also, to assessing the impact of proposed changes on the BBC public service activities. In this consultation, we set out our proposed approach on how we will assess proposed changes by the BBC to its public service activities. This is particularly relevant in the light of yesterday's announcement. And finally, to the procedures for enforcement of BBC competition requirements, and this would reflect back on your earlier discussion on BBC Studios, and this will be an area that's covered by that. Glenn's team will share the outcome of these consultations with this committee and with the Scottish Government when they're available. The Ofcom Scotland team will also continue to engage more generally with the committee across the range of our regulatory responsibilities as they affect your interests. We'll do so in tandem with our engagement with the Scottish Government to discuss their interest in this process, including the policy position they've clearly set out on representative content across all BBC outputs and in respect of commissioning and editorial practices, which will support the growth and sustainability of Scotland's creative industries. Convener, I hope that's helpful in setting out the current state of play from Ofcom's perspective. I was fortunate to be present for the evidence from the BBC and I'd be happy to answer questions in relation to my remarks and to reflect on the discussion from this morning's opening session.
Thank you very much, and can I say that I certainly welcome the role that you have been given, and you could see from our previous evidence session that there's going to have very high expectations of yourselves as a regulator in delivering on some of the scrutinising some of the areas that have been basically a constant bone of contention in terms of programme making in Scotland. Can I ask when the operating framework will be published and what it will contain, and will the operating framework will include a made outside London quota which the BBC will have to meet?
Yes. To be clear, the operating framework is made up of several constituent parts. The operating licence, which we are currently in the process of drawing up, which sets out performance requirements for the BBC, and that specifically will answer the question you just raised about representation of the UK properly, and we're working through that in terms of the requirements that we can impose on the BBC. The requirements in that are legally enforceable, so we're looking at the BBC's past performance. We're looking particularly through the eyes of the charter and the agreement, which make it one of the core public purposes, as you know, is reflecting and representing the diverse communities and peoples of the UK, the nations and regions, and that is a specific focus for us. So in terms of the operating framework, to go back to the point, there's the operating licence, which will set requirements for the BBC to meet in the year that comes. There are performance measurements, which will monitor how the BBC is doing. So, for example, it might look at how, in an ongoing way, the BBC is perceived by the audience in Scotland as delivering in terms of representation and programming that's relevant and so on. And then there are other tools we have within the operating framework. We can do an ad hoc review into any specific area at any point if we have particular concerns or interest in that area. So there's an overall operating framework. The operating licence itself is going to be put out to consultation at the end of March with a relatively long consultation period. So that will also hopefully take in the BBC's publication of their own creative plan, which will form part of the consultation along with any other input we have, including from Scotland.
Yes, I think it's fair to say that one of the big wins for Scotland and the charter is that there is a commitment to the creative industries in Scotland and delivering on that. And again, you will have an important role there. In my questioning this morning around the whole issue of lift and shift at the BBC, the answer is kind of deflected back to yourself and how you set the criteria for what is a Scottish company. I mean, clearly, the way it was presented this morning, that criteria sounds quite robust, but clearly from previous evidence sessions we've taken with the independent production sector, that's not felt to be the case. Could you see, for example, yourself toughening up that criteria further to address this problem, because it's been a problem for a number of years?
I think the straightforward answer to that is yes. It's something we've been considering actually in the last few weeks in the light of one specific complaint.
Well, could you tell us more about that, please?
Well, I'd rather not, because it's in the middle of the process on that. Right. So I think it would be unfair to, okay. to talk about that specifically, but I would say it's something I've taken a personal interest in. We have a very experienced team looking at it. You know, Ofcom does have an arrangement with the BBC that we set out the ways that the legal requirements should be interpreted. My view is that if that framework if people are adhering to that framework, meeting the legal requirements, but it's not meeting the spirit of what that is trying to do, then that needs to be revisited.
Right. I'm sure many people will welcome that. I'll pass on to Lewis MacDonald now.
Thank you very much. And on that theme, does that imply that you will seek to develop a more detailed set of criteria by which you make judgments about commissions and how they support the creative economy here in Scotland?
As I understand it, the process, and you have to forgive me, I was in broadcasting until 3 months ago, so I'm relatively new to regulation, but I have been looking at this in some detail. As I understand it, if we decide to review the framework and look at how we might tighten it up, we would put out a public consultation on that. We would need to put out a public consultation on that so that everybody can contribute their views, which I suspect there would be relatively vociferous views across the piece. The framework also potentially could apply to a wider range of broadcasters than just the BBC.
I was keen to explore that because clearly there are some issues that have arisen in relation to other broadcasters and the level. We talked this morning about the Screen Sector Leadership Group report from John McCormack, which found or raised some concerns about commissioning to the ITV network programmes from STV, and I wonder if there's how far the work you're doing currently in relation to the BBC has a pertinence and a relevance to that and other companies.
I think one of the merits of Ofcom taking over regulation of the BBC is we already have a role in regulating the other public service broadcasters, mm-hmm. so Channel 4, ITV, Channel 5. Mm-hmm. So we can take an overview of the whole broadcasting sector and also the whole health of the creative sector across the UK and in the individual nations, and that is a responsibility we should have. We should do the best to make sure that the creative sector is flourishing across the UK but in the individual nations as well, and that would underpin anything that we would do. And so as I say, I had the pleasure of reading that report. I thought it made some extremely valid observations and points, not just on this area, across the piece actually, and it was an impressive piece of work, but if we go out to consultation, it will be, you know, it'll be a relatively, we would have to look across the sector.
I was struck by the title of your report, which referred to the nations of the United Kingdom and their regions, and I think that implied a good level of recognition of the fact that Scotland is a nation which contains within it quite distinct regions. Is a made outside Glasgow criterion something that would be part of your consideration?
Well, it's something we can look at in future. I think that where we absolutely want to try and draw the line is we want the BBC has to be able to run its own affairs first and foremost. Sure. And ideally, we want to be in a position over the next 2 or 3 years when we're properly ensconced in this position as an independent regulator that we are addressing failures rather than being prescriptive to the BBC. So we'll monitor what they do. We'll see if they are truly representing the diverse communities, nations and regions of the UK. If there are areas that we feel we need to intervene in future, that is open to us. Because the one thing I should say is the operating licence is not a once-off for 11 years. We will set the first operating licence in the autumn following the consultation. My expectation is, and my hope is, it'll change over the years to come, and it needs to change to reflect the initiatives taken by the BBC, the changing consumption patterns of the audience, technology and so on. So we need to be able to be flexible in that, and part of that is dropping requirements where the BBC is performing and potentially putting in other requirements where there is a perception that the BBC is not performing sufficiently.
You already have a role in regulating ALIPA, among other channels. And just very briefly, how will that role be impacted, or will it change with the new responsibility for regulating BBC?
It shouldn't change. We do the role of Ofcom with other broadcasters is specifically laid out for each of those broadcasters. So the only way it'll change is that we'll have a wider view of the PSB landscape, if you like.
Thank you very much.
Tavi Scott.
Thank you. Can I ask further to Lewis McDonald's questioning? How do you avoid this framework becoming a numbers game argument as opposed to the quality? Is part of your assessment about that, or are we going to end up in an argument where, I don't know, Manchester produces X number of programmes, Glasgow produces X number of programmes, that ticks a big box in the argument you've just made, but actually quality is neither here nor there. I'm sure that's not what any of us want. So how are you dealing with this, what I suppose is a straightforward dilemma about how that framework should operate?
Yeah, you put your finger on the dilemma at the heart of this, really, which is, and I suspect it'll be, as I say, the operating licence will evolve. Where we are starting from, and this is very clear in the Charter and Agreement, in Schedule 2 of the Charter and Agreement, which is there's a presumption that Ofcom will take the existing trust targets and translate them across and increase some of them as necessary. That is a presumption there. But I would hope over time that some of those will fall away where the BBC is performing, so that we get away from the numbers game and look more at the quality of what is being turned out, if you like. There'll always be a role for numbers. Mm-hmm. You know, you have to have some framework to judge spend in Scotland, percentage of network originations made in Scotland. Those sort of things are very useful as part of it. But the numbers are only part of the assessment. And assessing the performance of the BBC in a robust way with a lot of audience research is going to be one of the key tools we use.
Yeah. Okay, thank you.
Do other members wish to come in? Jackson.
You used a phrase there, you said, where there is a perception that the BBC, well, perception can sometimes be informed by prejudice rather than evidence. I mean, I presume that you would want any intervention to be evidence-based and not simply be to react to any particular opinion that was floated at any particular time, which might actually not be substantially evidenced at all.
Yes, I mean, Ofcom operates in a very evidence-based way. So when I say a perception, it'll be a measured perception over time that we track. I wouldn't say we'd overreact. You know, these things come and go depending on, for example, you know, political climate or whatever. But we would dig down into, you know, perception of, for example, how people feel they're represented across Scotland. Do they feel there's programming that is there for them? Some of these things are measured already in the PSB reviews. We'd enhance that. We would combine that with measurements, as I say. So I think it has to be a combination both of audience research, which is done in a robust way, alongside actual things you can measure the BBC is doing.
Right, thank you.
Can you say a little bit more about how you're going to report back on the BBC's performance in Scotland, in particular with relation to support of the creative economy?
Yes, so we will issue an annual report every year. So the BBC will issue its annual report. We will issue an annual report every year, and an important part of that will be on the way the BBC is properly reflecting and representing the nation's. So it'll be done in the annual report. They could be specific pieces of work if we choose to do them, if we think it's an area of concern about the way the BBC is reflecting the nations properly. But the main tool will be in the annual report, which will include all the audience measurements that we've done, as well as the other measurements.
Right, okay. You'll have heard the discussion we had this morning about the new channel and the electronic programming guide, and understand that you have a role in that. You'll be aware how important it is to get public service content on that, on page one of that guide. Are you able to say a little bit more about what your role will be in that?
Yes, that's correct. I mean, it's very important to all the public service broadcasters that they have prominence on the EPGs across the programme guides, across the digital services, and Ofcom does have a role in ensuring that they get the appropriate prominence for their services in discussions with Sky, Virgin and Freeview. So we will have a role, and it's an important part of our role in making sure that public service content is available in the most prominent way possible to the audiences.
You see, a few years ago this came up when there was a launch of the local television channels in Scotland, and because of BBC ALPA, they struggled to get a prominent role, even though that role is supposed to go to public service broadcasters. And there were non-public service content on page one which could not be shifted to make way for the local TV stations. Is that a situation which you could see the new channel encountering as well?
Well, part of this is commercial negotiations, and Ofcom has a role in that, and we would have a view that we would make clear. In the end, we have limited powers over Sky, but we have a role, and make it clear that our view on prominence on the EPG is an important part of Sky's responsibility, for example, not to pick out just Sky, Virgin too.
Yes, but in Freeview, what's the situation with Freeview? Do you have more power there?
Well, the public service broadcasters themselves have a certain amount of sway over Freeview. So I would imagine Freeview, and also there's fewer channels on there, so they should be able to. But as Tony Hall made clear, this is a part of a negotiation. But you know, they have some EPG space already from channels that they put online. The other thing I would say is that EPGs, they're very important. They have been incredibly important. They remain important. But as we know, audience consumption is changing, and people are consuming their content online and via an on-demand in increasing numbers. So while it remains important, the audience is very savvy about finding the content they want to find.
Yeah. Is there any other points that you would like to make about the new channel and your role?
Well, I read the announcement. I've read the response and seen the response here this morning. You know, in terms of Ofcom's position, first of all, there probably will be a public interest test on it. It'll probably be the first one that we do after assuming our new responsibilities, because it is a significant new public service. But in approaching that, we weigh up market impact against the public purpose and the value of the public purpose that it's serving here. So, you know, that's how we approach that. In terms of, you know, the money that goes with it and the investment in the creative economy, and in terms of one of our remits, which is to make sure that the people of the nations are properly represented, I would say it's a positive step. It's a significant amount of money for an organisation that faces quite substantial financial challenges in the next few years.
Thank you. Emma Harper.
Thank you. It's picking up about reporting and using evidence, because evidence is actually is really important. There's so many sceptics out there. We get tweets about it, and, you know, Question Time audience member choice is one that I read about, reporting Scotland content, and even referendum coverage. So how would you communicate to the public if you are doing an evidence-based investigation, for instance, looking at some of these issues?
Well, we have a very established editorial standards procedure, which wouldn't now cover the BBC fully, as we have covered other broadcasts in the past. Now, it remains that people, if they have issues about accuracy or impartiality of BBC News, should go to the BBC first. But if they're not satisfied with the response they get from the BBC, they can then come to Ofcom. So if there are individual issues that people want to bring to Ofcom, they're not satisfied with the BBC's response, they will be able to do that. For the first time, they'll be able to go to an independent regulator for an independent assessment. And I think we have a good, strong process. We have a robust process, and we have a strong track record in dealing with issues of independence and impartiality.
So then that's great. So how do we then ensure that is communicated back to members of the public in a wider, people that might not complain or need, you know, feedback?
Well, we ourselves will try and make it clear where we can do. And I think it's, you know, where if constituents come to you and ask about how they can approach this, we would encourage the word to be out there that this is a new opportunity for people. If they go to the BBC, they're not satisfied on editorial issues, that they're not satisfied with the response from the BBC, they then have an option for the first time to come to an independent regulator for an independent assessment of that.
Can I just pitch in a couple of additional thoughts on that? I mean, this committee will be aware that there's a new memorandum of understanding that exists between Ofcom, the two governments, UK and Scottish, and the Parliament. And that includes provisions in it about us giving evidence here, as we are today, as I've done in front of the Rural Economy Committee in the past few months as well. And we're very open to doing that, you know, as frequently as necessary to respond to exactly that type of question about ensuring the public really understand the nature of some of these quite difficult, you know, these difficult things that are based in kind of evidence-based regulation.
Thanks. Can I say I welcome that and I hope we will see you again. Have you made any kind of estimate in the number of complaints from Scotland do you expect to receive in your first year as regulator? There's a capacity issue, obviously.
There is a capacity issue, yes. So encourage people, but not too much as well as it. No. Yes, we have done. We have been recruiting extra people. We have a reasonable idea if you look at how many complaints at the moment go to the trust, which the BBC executive deal with, and they go to the trust on appeal, if you like. You know, it's a fair guess, I would say, to say that people might see the fact there is an independent regulator, there may be an increase in the number of appeals, if you like. I think we're in a position that we feel confident that we have the capacity to start with to deal with those complaints, but we have the possibility of recruiting extra people if we see that is going to be necessary.
Right. So have you put a number on it?
On Scotland or on the UK? We haven't put an exact number either on the UK or on Scotland, no.
Right, okay.
I would say, though, in terms of our editorial standards team, Glenn was talking about the increase in number of colleagues that we have from Ofcom working in Edinburgh now. Part of that is my team, and part of that is the team that will deal as part of Ofcom's editorial standards team with complaints.
Richard Lockhead, did you have a supplementary on that?
It's a general question, it's not supplementary.
Right, okay.
I've got a supplementary.
Okay.
It's just in terms of the process for complaints, obviously someone would contact yourselves. How would you then investigate that particular complaint if it came into yourselves?
You mean generally on complaints?
If someone had a complaint about, obviously about BBC programme, editorial content, whatever. What would your process be?
Well, there's a general process, which is, you know, we obviously deal with a lot of complaints already. And complaints on privacy, for example, come straight to us anyway, rather than to the broadcaster. But the complaint comes in, the team make an initial assessment of the complaint to see whether it needs further investigation. And then the team will investigate. And that's a process of potentially going, looking at the complaint on the face of it, is there a case to answer, in which case going back to the broadcaster, potentially talking to the complainant a little bit more about the complaint, going to the broadcaster and asking further questions if we have them, and then making our assessment of whether there is whether the complaint has validity or not. We would then issue an initial finding on the complaint, which people can comment on, and we would take that into consideration, and we'll issue a final decision on the complaint.
Okay, thanks.
Richard Lockhead.
I've got a slightly general question off a tangent. Clearly, Ofcom have your responsibilities, and today's been talking about the BBC. But nowadays, someone can just set up their own news channel, and they can set themselves up as a, you know, community news website or whatever it may be, and they can just go on and do their own thing. Have you got any general comments on about whether the regulatory framework is keeping up to date with, you know, today's technologies?
Well, we license 2,000 channels in the UK. It's always a challenge because technology is moving very quickly and we have to try and keep up with it. If essentially, for example, to take TV channels, if it looks like a TV channel, it needs to be licensed by Ofcom, and you know, we would tend to, and therefore it has to abide by the Ofcom regulations. So, you know, if we become aware of channels and we do monitor that are not licensed, that look like TV channels, we will go out and impose that or close them down.
Well, if it's a news channel that just occasionally uses broadcast.
Well, I haven't come across that much.
Yeah.
I just wondered.
Tavish Scott, did you want to come back in?
Yes, please. Different question altogether for me. Yes. Thank you. I actually wanted to ask about your wider responsibilities over telecommunications, because I asked a question earlier on about broadband to the BBC and the rollout of broadband and therefore the ability to, for people who don't have superfast broadband, to access online content that, in this case, the BBC are more and more doing. I know that Faeries Telecom are looking at expanding operations into different parts of Scotland. They think there's a business venture. They don't need any public money to do it. I know it's probably more a question for Glenn Preston, but have you had those discussions with Faeries Telecom? Where are they? And my understanding is that at the moment they're being told they cannot get a frequency authorisation. Is that so? Who ultimately makes that decision, and what can be done to make sure that in this case some parts of Scotland do, otherwise you're just not going to get superfast broadband, possibly could do so?
Yeah. I think, I mean, the first thing to say is we absolutely recognise the challenge that you articulated in the session with the BBC earlier on. And that's a conversation that we've had both with the Scottish Government, so with Fergus Ewing as the lead Cabinet Secretary, and with the Rural Economy and Connectivity Committee, generally some of these big infrastructure challenges that exist to roll out broadband, particularly to rural areas in Scotland. It also picks up the point that Lewis MacDonald made earlier about, you know, Scotland not being a single place in that regard, and that's something that we're going to have to look at across our regulatory responsibilities, so not just in relation to fixed broadband, for example, but mobile coverage. And you asked the question of Kevin earlier in relation to our broadcasting responsibilities too. Faeries Telecom point, yes, we have spoken to them. We are scheduled to speak to them again in the next couple of weeks. I don't know the specific answer to the frequency point, but I'm very happy to find that out and let the committee know. It is worth saying that we did a digital communications review last year, which is all about things like opening up ducts and poles on the BT infrastructure network to allow for exactly this type of increased competition, so that we can improve broadband services across not just Scotland but other parts of the UK too. And that's that in our next annual plan, which we'll publish in the course of the next few weeks as well. That will be a critical thing that we'll be doing in 17 and 18 to follow up that proposition to really try and drive improvement. We are working with the UK government on their broadband universal service obligation. I think there'll be more details on that in the context of the UK Digital Economy Bill in the coming weeks, and also with the Scottish Government on their R100 programme, which commits to superfast by 2021. And there are some significant questions there, I think, for both governments about how these things interact. And you know, we're very happy to facilitate a conversation between them so that the governments can achieve those public policy aims, so that you know, people who want to access content online, as we've discussed, will be able to do so.
I guess my concern is that governments can set these big targets, but years and years and years will go past before anything actually happens to people that we actually serve as elected members. So here we've got a commercial company wanting to invest, put up the masts, make it happen, and at the moment I'm being told they can't. And what I'm asking you to do is to go and find out where that is and get on with it, rather than be waiting to 2021 for anything to happen.
Yeah, well, we're very happy to make that commitment to come back to you with the detail on it.
That's good, Anne. Thank you.
I mean, on that subject, in the context of the BBC, you increasingly get a situation where people are paying a licence fee, and some of those people aren't going to get the services as the services increasingly move online, and that must be something that I take it you'll push very hard on.
I must say, I mean, you know, considerable amount of my time sitting on the executive at Ofcom is spent with my colleagues who are much better versed in this than me, talking about how the various tools that we are looking at, the various pressures we can put on individual organisations, and the discussions with government about how we can speed up broadband rollout across the UK. And particularly, you know, I think that one of the strongest tools we have is the annual report on which shows how the nations and how the regions of the nations are doing, and rural areas in particular.
One other additional point I would make there is that not all of the solutions here are going to be regulatory, so we won't have all the kind of tools in our kit to be able to respond to that, and it will require both governments, UK and Scottish, industry. I mean, it was helpful to hear the BBC say that they would engage in some of these sorts of questions about the fact that their services will be delivered online, and recognising the challenges that exist for people who might not be able to access it.
Okay. Stuart McMillan, you had another question, did you?
Just in terms of the announcement from yesterday from the BBC, I would assume that the Ofcom were made fully aware of the announcement before it took place. Well, fully aware of the details.
Not the details. I was told the day before that there was going to be an announcement, and I was given the broad outline of it, yes.
Okay, thank you.
Could you just tell us when you expect a member of the Ofcom board to be appointed by Scottish ministers?
We're just about to start that process. We're talking to the Scottish Government. As you say, the appointment's made by Scottish ministers about the job description, and we hope to go to advert in the next handful of weeks, and then ideally have a candidate appointed before this Parliament breaks for recess, with somebody coming into post over the summer. So August, September time, that we would hope that the Ofcom Scotland board member would be in place.
If there are no other questions from members, I think we'll wrap up now. And I'd like to thank both our witnesses for coming today, and we'll now go into private session. Thank you.